This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
From North, South, East, and West, North America, Japan, and back again, this is your home for modern-day wrestling. With the occasional trip back in time, it's Place to Be Nation's main event. Now let's head into Studio B with your host, Scott Criscolo, and the Godfather, Nate Milton.
Place to Be Nation, welcome back to your home for everything modern-day mat work, here, there, and everywhere. It is Place to Be Nation's main event. I am your co-host, Scott Criscolo. We are in episode 104. And we got a fun show tonight because we got a lot of stuff to talk about. WWE, little Ring of Honor, WWE news, a big release, a death, which is very sad today. Kind of came out of nowhere, but maybe didn't come out of nowhere. We'll talk about that. And then in the B block, it is time for our newest edition of the New Japan Classic Match Pick, and it was my turn, and I picked a doozy. And I have a feeling, because my co-host is up next, I have a feeling I know where he's going to go with our next pick. But let me bring him in, co-host of the Kings of Sport, co-host of a myriad of other great podcasts. And I did get a telegram from Byron Allen, because he still kicks it old school. And he said that we could be getting a grant soon, Godfather Nate Milton.
Well, you know, Scotty, when you deal with the world of moguls, moguls can be a little bit eccentric. So, you know, you might get a telegram or a flying pigeon with a note tied to his leg. So they communicate in different ways from us normal people.
Exactly.
But, yeah, this is going to be a fun show this week, Scotty. Got a lot to talk about, a lot to get into. So, yeah, I think that this is one of the few shows I'm going to be doing this week just because I'm on vacation. But I figured this week, of all weeks, I needed to be here because I got some thoughts on some things, and I need to get those thoughts out.
We got to get them out, brother. We got to get them out. And Byron did say to me that the check is coming up next. I'm like, all right, there we go. Okay.
Best segue in the business.
Most generic segue in the business. Oh, God. Anyway, Brother Nate, I love having you on, man.
Hey, why do a moonsault when a wrist lock will work just as well?
Exactly, yes. What's the best move to go to a commercial break? We'll finish this
chin lock
next. All right. Well, of course, we are out of Money in the Bank, which happened this past Sunday in Chicago. By the way, Steve Wille, Brother Nate, will be joining us in the B block. He was at NXT Takeover on Saturday night with one of his youngins. So we will chat with him about that briefly before we dive into the New Japan match. So we won't talk about NXT in this block. We'll hold off and talk about NXT in the B block. We had some interesting surprises that took place on Sunday. The two briefcases were interesting. One was fairly predictable. One I picked. I didn't think it was going to be a cash-in on that night, but I picked it. Yeah. Here is the rundown of the results. The Bludgeon Brothers in the pre-show retained the SmackDown Tag Team titles with a win over the club. That was in 7 minutes. Daniel Bryan beat a certain Big Cass by submission at 16-19. Well, we got some news on Mr. Cass shortly. Bobby Lashley defeated Sami Zayn in 6:35. Seth Rollins beat Elias to retain his Intercontinental Championship at 17 minutes, although he no longer is Intercontinental Champion. Alexa Bliss won the Ladies' Money in the Bank ladder match at 18:30. Roman Reigns defeated Jinder Mahal in 15 minutes and 44 seconds that neither of us will ever get back. Carmella defeated Asuka to retain the SmackDown Women's title at 11:10 with the return of the chinless one, the walking Q-tip, Mr. James Ellsworth. So are you happy now? Is he in your top 100 now because he's back? Did he earn the spot
I mean, he
now?
Was in my top 100 anyway, but this just... Well, we this only, just cements it.
We only got 10 left, so I don't even want to know who you kicked off.
This cements his legacy.
yes, AJ Styles retained his WWE Championship in a 5-star epic last man standing match with Shinsuke Nakamura. That match, Nate, 31-15, and it was delicious from bell to bell. We'll get into
that. The outcome was a bit of a surprise as well.
Yes, it was. I have a theory on that, though. I'll tell you that in a minute. I'll tell you about it in a minute. All right, here's the big one. Ronda Rousey and Nia Jax, your girl, for the Raw Women's title. All out of the blue, out comes Ronda, who wins by DQ because she gets smacked by Alexa Bliss, who comes out with the briefcase, knocks everybody around, and your girl Nia gets punked. And Alexa Bliss, once again, is the Raw Women's Champion. And then in the last match, which was no surprise, in 1953, Braun Strowman wins the Money in the Bank men's briefcase. Overall thoughts of the show before we dive into some specifics.
It was a decent show. Like there was one really great match, the AJ and Nock match. I thought Rousey once again overperformed. And I thought that, you know, the two Money in the Bank matches were solid. Everything else, yeah, it was there. I'd say it was a thumbs up show. Wasn't the best show of the year, but it was better than some of these other B shows have been.
Mm-hmm. I actually thought top to bottom, this was one of the best shows of the year. I might be upgrading it a little bit.
Mm.
But I liked it a lot. The only match that I thought was a stinker, and I'm not even going to blame him for it, is Lashley and Sami Zayn. I thought that match was average. I love Lashley, though. I really do. He's like one of my favorite. I've always liked Lashley, believe it or not. But I don't know how much you were going to get out of that match, so I'm like, all right, whatever. You know, it's like all good.
I mean, that match had one of the worst builds on the card, leading up to it.
It was dreadful.
So.
It was absolutely dreadful. I think you're going to see more Lashley moving up as we move ahead through into the summertime.
I like what they teased on Monday. I like Lashley and the Big Dog. I think that could be fun.
I think it could be a lot of fun. I liked the opener. We'll get into Big Cass specifically in a couple minutes, but I thought that match was very good. It was a lot better than I thought it was going to be. I mean, he got just over 16 minutes out of Cass, and that's I mean, it wasn't horrendous. I mean, I didn't think it was horrendous. I thought it was okay.
No, I think, though, my view on that match, it's kind of colored by what happened later.
Right.
Because it's kind of like, that 16 minutes we could have given to something else if you're just going to get rid of the dude.
Yeah, that's true, too. Seth and Elias had a fantastic match. Of course, Seth Rollins no longer Intercontinental Champion. He lost on Monday on Raw to Dolph Ziggler, who now I think is a six-time Intercontinental Champion. Which is good because I think that kind of boosts, that little duo of Dolph and Drew McIntyre.
Drew.
And Drew's another reason why I think somebody got booted, but we'll get to that in a minute. I thought Carmella Asuka as a match wasn't too bad. I was not a fan of the ending, but I think Asuka, but everybody says, and I'm not saying it's because I knock Ellsworth. I think the problem right now is that Asuka, let's put it this way, Nate, we talked about this on a couple of our GWWE countdown shows about your boy Booker. Asuka is Booker T and Ronda is Goldberg. It's the same thing. Ronda is now getting all the sexy storylines, and Asuka's kind of now down the ladder a little bit, and she's kind of being treated like just another babyface. And I know everybody's pissed off at that, but look, clearly of that trio that was in in NXT, Carmella's the only one that's kept her nose clean. So I think she's kind of earned it, to be honest with you. I think she's earned the right to keep her title and to stay strong. That's my opinion.
I wasn't too mad at that outcome.
Yeah, did that shock you?
It shocked me a little bit, but I'm not too upset with the outcome. My bigger issue is it feels very much like they don't know what to do with Asuka right now. And it's like There are some people on the card where you can just kind of have them floating around and doing nothing, like a Ty Dillinger, and it doesn't really matter. It doesn't really affect them. But Asuka's somebody that should be handled with care, should be right. Somebody that is special on the main roster. And I think Asuka and maybe even Charlotte to some degree have been kind of diminished since their match at WrestleMania.
Right. Yeah, Charlotte's been kind of put on the back burner. I mean, look, this is Carmella's time as champion. I don't know what will happen at our next outing, which is, of course, Extreme Rules, which is in the wonderful city of Pittsburgh on July 15th, I think it is. Yeah, because it's actually, I was talking about this with my PIC, Mr. Rosero. This is the first time in a while that the pay-per-view will not be falling on St. Mary's weekend. Very rare. It's weekend before. Very strange. Anyway, I digress. So we'll see what happens at that pay-per-view and what the next step is. I have a feeling we may get some kind of multi-person match between Asuka, Charlotte, maybe Carmella, maybe somebody else, maybe a four-way. Juice it up a little bit, you know?
To me, it doesn't even make sense to take the title off her until SummerSlam at the earliest, just because you've brought Ellsworth back into the act, so you got to give that time to marinate.
I agree. Ah, you stole one of my verbs. I love that. Things marinate. That's fantastic. Love it. Now, I had said to a few people while we were watching the show that night, and I've said it to people at work, wrestling fans, we've been chatting it up. We obviously know that AJ is arguably the best worker in the company, maybe the best worker in the world. Obviously, there's a couple of guys wrestling in a federation we'll be talking about in the B block that may dispute that, but you can't argue that AJ is probably one of the top five workers in the world and probably WWE's best worker right now.
Yep.
However, and he hasn't really had, I mean, when was his last stinker? Maybe last year's SummerSlam against Owens? It's the only thing I could think of, really. And that wasn't even a stinker. That was like a three, which for him is like a one.
It was just subpar for AJ.
Right. However, in your opinion, with this match, and we've had, this was what, the fifth big match that these two have had. WrestleMania, Backlash, Greatest Royal Rumble, SmackDown, and now here, Money in the Bank. So this is the fifth match since early April between Nock and AJ. This one was obviously the best of the five.
By far.
By far. Is this the match where we can finally say that AJ has stepped into the dimension of Shawn Michaels, where he is now officially untouchable?
It's interesting. I think...
Because that, you could have, that was the first match... Let me just get this point out quick before I forget. This was the first match where you could plucked AJ out of the match, stuck Shawn into the match, and I don't think a single thing would have changed. And I think that's the first time we've seen that, for me anyway.
Yeah, I think if we're just strictly talking about the world of the WWE, yes, I think this was another step up the ladder for AJ, another step up the rung. But to be honest, like, I think AJ has been that guy forever, just in smaller companies.
Right.
Like, if you know, when we go back and look at some of the TNA stuff, AJ's the guy that always jumps off the screen week after week in the middle of the garbage, pun intended, with Puppet, that company put us through. To me, AJ's a guy you could throw in there with anybody in the world and have a halfway decent match.
Right.
And so I think now he's kind of got to that level in the WWE where, yeah, this is the guy head and shoulders above the rest. You can make an argument that Rollins might be number two. But whoever you choose, they're still not up to AJ's level. So, yeah, I would say he is probably the closest thing they've had to a Shawn Michaels, a consistent top in-ring guy that makes everybody in there with him better. He's probably the closest guy they've had to Shawn in a long time.
Yeah, there's no doubt. I mean, he is at that level now. Is Nock losing a big deal? Nah, not really.
No.
I tell you something, though. I have a weird theory, and I usually think outside the box on some of this nonsense, and I I don't know if I'm off totally off base. WWE has a house show on June 29th, which is next Friday? Next Friday. In Tokyo. I'm going to go out on a limb and say Knock wins the title there.
Yeah, that wouldn't be the worst idea. It would add importance to their house shows, which they've done from time to time, doing title switches. And I think AJ was the beneficiary of the last big title change on a house show. When he was it the U.S. title or the IC?
He won on a house show at the Garden. AJ beat Owens. Yeah, it was the U.S. title at the Garden.
Yep. I think that'd be a cool idea. I think there's a lot you can do with this heel Knock character, who is kind of finally, it's all coming together. Like, we got the character work in this feud for so long, but the matches weren't living up to what the guys were doing with the characters. And we finally got everything that culminated on Sunday. And it's like, yeah, I could see them moving on, but I at the same time, you know, I'm not mad if they decide to keep this thing going and switch the belt on a Knock.
Now, the big rumor that's been kind of jostled around is that AJ's next opponent is Joe. Now, we've seen a myriad of AJ and Joe. If you watched, obviously, if you're watching TNA, and Nate, you obviously being our scholar. How many big matches did they have? Like pay-per-view matches in TNA, AJ and Joe, maybe three, four.
Yeah, I want to say they probably had about three singles matches, and then of course the big Unbreakable match where you had the three-way with AJ, Joe, and Daniels.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I remember that match. They talked about it on Pritchard's podcast. They talked about that three-way. So, I mean, there's a lot of options because it's AJ. The options are endless because he's so damn good.
Yeah.
So whatever we see in July in Pittsburgh, or even more importantly, in August in Brooklyn, we're going to be entertained either way. I want to talk about the next thing I want to throw out. Roman and the greatest wrestler of all time, who put on a 7-star match, Meltzer, the great Jinder Mahal. No. Was the point of that feud for Roman to finally get cheered by everybody by facing somebody that everybody universally hates? Did that even work?
Like, no, it didn't
work.
It did. They failed miserably.
It's not like nobody cheered anybody. Nobody cared.
Yeah, exactly. They're like, the idea was, we'll put Roman in here with Jinder, so that way Jinder will get all the heat and Roman will be the babyface. But instead, nobody cared about either guy.
Exactly.
Just like, again, between this match and the Cass Bryan match, that's 30 minutes you could have given me. You could have given to something else.
A nice Iron Man with AJ Knock. Let him go another 29 minutes.
Hey, I would not complain.
Nope, I would not have either. I guess the rumor's still solid. We are still going to get Roman and Brock in Brooklyn. We'll delve more into that down the line. All right, let's talk about... So anything else about Sunday you want to mention? All right, Braun winning is not a huge shock, because that was talked about. But I'm curious. I'm actually looking forward to how they can write weekly programming with him holding a briefcase.
Honestly, I think the only reason he got that briefcase is because somebody likes alliteration in the back office.
Yep.
So he's Mr. Munster in the bank. And then they're like, that's a cute little pun. But he really doesn't need it. Like, right. I thought that was maybe my one big I had two kind of booking qualms with this show. Number one was that Braun got the Money in the Bank because, A, I think you can build a Braun-Brock match without the briefcase, and B, I thought that briefcase should have been on SmackDown, so we separate the briefcases.
I agree with you. I think the briefcase on SmackDown would have been a big deal. I do.
Joe, you could have given it to Joe. You could have given it to Hell, you could have given it to Kofi, and we could have had a great little, you know, AJ Kofi 1 month feud, which would have been cool.
And the briefcase would have been full of pancakes. The briefcase would have had all weird colors.
That could have been fun. That could have, because you would have had two baby faces, and I think, yeah, you AJ the serious guy, Kofi kind of the jokester. Yeah, that could have worked for a good little one-off feud. But
AJ have pancakes in his bag or something, or you know,
yes,
the briefcase has a big thing of videos. Why not?
The other booking decision that kind of made me scratch my head a little bit. Not that she doesn't make a fine champion, was the women's match. Uh-huh. With Nia and Rousey, which I thought, again, this is a match that should have taken, this whole scenario should have taken place at SummerSlam. Because I think this feud felt very microwaved.
It did feel microwaved, absolutely. I agree 100%.
And, like, you had the 1 week with Stephanie basically kind of, like, did the Jedi mind trick and turned Nia heel, I guess, kind of. And
yeah, I know, right?
And he's like, she said something about you. Are you going to sit there and let her say that? And like, no, I won't sit there and let her say that. I guess I'm a bad guy now. But yeah, I thought they could have stretched this feud out a little bit more and really built it up so that by the time we get to SummerSlam, I think they wanted this to kind of be, if not the number one match on the show, the number two match on the show. And while it was a good match at Money in the Bank, I don't feel like it was like I don't feel it was as big as it could have been. They allowed it to breathe more. Like, I loved everything that they did in the match. I thought, you know, again, they found a way to come up with a match that makes Ronda look like $1 million. Nia still looks strong at the end of the match. I didn't even mind the Alexa stuff. It's just, we could have done this 2 months down the road instead of shooting everything right now. And now we have to suspend Ronda Rousey for a month because we have to find a way in storyline to keep these two apart.
Exactly. Yep, I agree. I thought she looked awesome Monday on Raw, by the way.
Yeah.
I think what they were trying to do I think they're trying to make Money in the Bank like the fifth big show, which is, I think, why they booked like this giant 6 week gap between Backlash and Money in the Bank. I think they're trying to make Money in the Bank replace like King of the Ring as like the big fifth show. So that's why I think they had Nia and Ronda here instead of waiting till Brooklyn. That's a good point, Nate. I think in the normal sense, they would have if they didn't think they needed to jack this show up. Know what I mean? So I think that's an interesting possibility. Anyway, of course, you can watch Money in the Bank on the WWE Network. And again, our next pay-per-view outing, let me get the official date here. Our next pay-per-view outing is, well, actually, the next official outing, according to Wikipedia, is, of course, the UK tournament. The United Kingdom tournament, which is taking place, it's going to air this weekend. It's going to air, or is it next week? Let me see. Monday and Tuesday, it'll be on the network from the venerable Royal Albert Hall. Then after that, it's Extreme Rules. And that is, yes, July 15th at the PPG Paints Arena in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Somebody else likes alliteration.
I know, PPG Paints in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Thank God we don't have Brad on a show to say that. So let's move on to the news, because obviously we have a lot of news and notes. Let's start with this first point. Apparently, there was a story out there that Ring of Honor was going to do a show at Madison Square Garden. I'm trying to find the – let me open up a window here. I think Lords of Pain might have had it. But it is being blocked by WWE. And, of course, everybody's making the WWE out to be the bad guy. And I guess in theory they are. However, what are your thoughts on this whole scenario before we move on to the specifics? I want to make sure I get this article right. But what were your thoughts at first about Ring of Honor going to the Garden in the first place?
Yeah, I was on Rwanda SmackDown with John Pollock a couple weeks ago, and I think it was the night, the week that interview came out with Sinclair, and then they had voiced their desire to run MSG. And my thought was, it was a bold move. It was a smart move financially, because I think you could sell tickets on just the notion of Ring of Honor in MSG during WrestleMania week, like, without even announcing who's on the card, you've already got, you know, buys just based off of the novelty of that. You know, I think seeing how enthusiastic a lot of the fans have been about All In, I think you could have had a lot of that energy transfer and continue and sustain through WrestleMania with the announcement of that if they were able to make the deal. Mm-hmm. But also, I think it's weird because I don't quite know, Scotty, if Ring of Honor is big enough for MSG yet, but I do know they're too big for Hammerstein. I think they've outgrown Hammerstein, so it's like, what's the next best thing? Like, do we jump up to MSG or do we go out to Nassau? Like, what's that next step for Ring of Honor?
Yeah, here's the story. According to it is believed that Ring of Honor may have debuted at MSG during WrestleMania 35 week, which of course is at MetLife, because all of the here's an interesting thing. All of the arena stuff that was going to happen that weekend, Hall of Fame Friday, Takeover Saturday, was going to be at Barclays, not the Garden. Now, I went to, obviously in 2013, there was no NXT. We went to Ring of Honor at Hammerstein Friday night, and then Saturday we went to the Hall of Fame at the Garden, which is one of my favorite nights ever as a wrestling fan. And then obviously Sunday at MetLife. So with that, does this mean, first off, that WWE may be switching things up and we may have some stuff at, will that be the first ever NXT takeover at Madison Square Garden? That would be huge from a marketing perspective, you know? MSG officials recently reached out to wrestling promotions about working together after they were not happy over how WWE had been using the Barclays Center in nearby Brooklyn and how none of the WrestleMania 35 week events were booked at MSG. Well, that's because the Dolans are assholes, and, well, really, that's the only reason you need. Who's going to be the new Raw General Manager? Isaiah? Great.
Charles Oakley?
That's right. John Starks? He'll miss everything. you know, my take on this is, and I'm going to get slaughtered for this, but whatever. That's what great podcasts do. I think WWE is doing Ring of Honor a favor because I don't think they were going to sell out Madison Square Garden. I think they were going to take a bath. I really do.
Interesting.
I don't think they were going to get 22,000. This isn't, I know it's Ring of Honor and we can all do the general platitudes that, hey, it's Ring of Honor, they can sell out anything. But I don't know if they were going to sell out Madison Square Garden, particularly on the same night as either NXT TakeOver or the Hall of Fame, depending on what the class is. I don't know. They would have really had to borrow, beg, and steal. It would have had to be like an all-in show. That's just my opinion.
Yeah.
I don't think you were going to get a sellout at the Garden. I don't. You would have had to get Kenny, or you would have had to borrow some New Japan stuff and have a Kenny Okada match or something. Something other than just Ring of Honor to bring that in. That's just my opinion. I don't know if they would have sold the Garden out. So I have a feeling that WWE backhandedly did Ring of Honor a favor. Because I think they can go somewhere else. I'm sure there's a venue that they can go to.
Yeah, that's the question. Because I think, I'm kind of with you in that I don't quite know if they would have sold out the Garden. It would have depended on, like, I think, you know, you get maybe halfway there just based off of novelty,
right,
and based off of it being WrestleMania week and you're gonna have consumers there. But then the other half is who's on the show, and
right,
you know, do you get the New Japan people in here? Do you get, you know, the same kind of crew that put All In together to bump up the ticket sales? So I can see what you're saying with that. The question is, though, do they go back to Hammerstein, which kind of feels like a regression, or do you maybe not go for the big fish, which would be MSG, but go for kind of that second tier and go to someplace like Nassau?
That's entirely possible. MetLife is going to be tough, and we won't belabor this point now. We'll talk more about this when we get into 2019, but travel in 2013 was a bitch, believe me. You are coming to MetLife, right? I thought you were coming. You better be bringing, the goods that weekend. We need all hands on deck for that weekend, Brother Nate. So I expect you there. Now I think that travel was a pain in the neck in 2013. Buses, long trains. It wasn't easy. But MetLife's at 80,000 for that show, for a show that top to bottom was eh. So it'll be interesting to see what happens between the Garden, Barclays, WWE, and all this other stuff. But there'll be no big Ring of Honor show at the Garden on WrestleMania weekend.
I think one of the interesting things, real quick, to kind of wrap up this talking point of this particular news story is, do they get any blowback with Barclays? Because this is very much like trying to get back with your ex, but you're still trying to keep your current.
Yep.
It's just so. Does Barclays feel like they're the side chick now? So it'll be interesting to see what that kind of relationship is with the WWE going forward.
I agree. And I say that because both buildings are great. WWE is successful in both. I've been to the Garden for two things. I've been at MSG for WrestleMania 20, and I was there for a Raw / Saturday Night's Main Event taping in 2007. Mm. And I've been at Barclays for every SummerSlam, a couple of takeovers, and sports stuff, obviously, some Nets games. So both venues are awesome. So that I can't argue. All right. Next up, let's talk about the big personnel move that was made. Speaking of New Yorkers.
who might be looking for a place to, who yeah, might be looking for a home.
Exactly. Big Cass was dumped on, I guess it was Tuesday. He was booted. And we have seen a lot of stories, but this is the official story about Big Cass. This is from, I'm seeing this on Lords of Pain. Multiple insider sources are telling Sports Illustrated that the reason Big Cass was fired by WWE was due to his personal conduct while heavily drinking on the recent European tour and being intoxicated in public. A Pro Wrestling Sheet reports of one incident where some of the wrestlers were on a bus that was being chauffeured for talent. Apparently, Cass got stuck in the bathroom because the lock was broken. Cass thought he was being pranked. After being in there for a while, he angrily broke down the door, which caused the rest of the group on the bus to not be able to use the bathroom in private. Apparently, there are some more incident reports that are coming out that have yet to be verified. So, apparently he buried himself.
First of all, I just love that you brought up the drunk in public, because that always reminds me, whenever I hear that phrase, of my favorite Ron Tater Salad White joke. Shout out to the Blue Collar Comedy Tour. He's like, I was in a bar and they threw me out and I got a ticket for being drunk in public. Like, I didn't want to be drunk in public. I wanted to be drunk in the bar. You put me in the public. Like that. I don't know why, but like Ron Tater Salad White, just like I like that guy. Like I hope he never has a scandal where I have to disavow my appreciation for him.
He's the cigar and scotch guy, right?
Yes,
right,
yes.
That's the guy I thought of. I like him too. I wanted to make sure that was him.
Yeah, the rest of them are kind of like Larry the Cable Guy and Jeff Foxworthy and the other guy. But then you got like Ron White, who just kind of stands out amongst this group. He's the Dean Martin of the Blue Collar Comedy Tour.
Yes, I like that. That's a good combination. I like that.
But with Cass, it feels like, no pun intended, he got the big head. It feels like he knew that he was going to get this big push, particularly with everything that went down with Enzo. And so you had these reports coming out about, you know, being drunk in public. You also have the thing with the little person Daniel Bryan a few weeks ago.
Yes. Yep.
Where that story came out where he was only supposed to go so far and he went further than the agents and maybe even Vince wanted him to go. And that's not smart. Like if Vince McMahon says, hey, this is enough right here, pal, and you go three steps further than that, that's not going to boost you up in the eyes of the boss. Yes.
Absolutely.
It feels very much like a guy that maybe got a little full of himself, maybe was feeling himself too much, and it sucks in one sense, Scott, because there was something there with Big Cass. Like, to me, he wasn't useless or a waste of space on the roster. There was some potential with him, particularly with, you know, how much Vince loves big guys. There was a potential and a path for him to have success. But as we saw with Enzo, attitude can make you or break you. Even in the wrestling business, where it's supposed to be, you know, the wild, wild west and men are men and you know, testosterone rules, yep. You still got to pay attention to the boss. Like, this is a publicly traded company. You can't be out here acting like an idiot. And so it's crazy, like you said, that Carmella is the only one out of this group that is still on the roster. And I think if you had put that question to people 3 years ago, nobody would have had that one.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. So, and I think the other thing is, we've got three guys on this roster that essentially look exactly the same. Big Cass, Baron Corbin, and Drew McIntyre.
That's why Baron got the haircut.
Baron got the haircut, and Drew now is actually the better worker anyway. So, what it came down to is, two other guys looked exactly like him, and he was the pain in the ass. So, he's the idiot.
It's like Vince is playing Pokemon. He's like, I've already got two Charizards. I don't need another.
Steve Willey would have loved that comparison when he comes on later. So, I mean, I'm sure he'll wind up in Impact. I don't think there's any doubt about that.
Yeah, I could easily see. It's funny, though, because I think Impact might be one of the few spots from the land, because I don't, unless he changes his attitude, I don't see him as one of these guys that's going to love the indies.
No, he looks like one of those guys that would be a dick on the indies.
Yeah.
You know? So, we'll see what happens from here on out. But he is now gone from the company, and I guess jobbing twice to Daniel Bryan was his way of being. Thanks. See ya.
And you can't teach that.
And you can't teach that. The other news that I want to talk about, I know we wanted to talk a lot about Vader. We could get more into Vader in B block, but we could talk about Vader here too. We can cross it over, actually. But one more thing I wanted to bring up. Apparently, there's going to be a new show coming out. NXT UK. So finally, these British guys are finally going to get some shine. And apparently, they're going to be adding two belts. So it's going to pretty much be another promotion. They're going to add a women's title and a tag title to go with, of course, your current UK champion. I cannot believe his name just went right out of my head.
Still Pete Dunne?
Oh, yeah, Pete Dunne. Yes, thank you. I was about to say Trent Seven, but that was a wrong bearded guy. yes. He is still your UK champion. And he can finally get some shine now.
Yeah.
I think that one of the things that kind of hurt Tyler Bate was that I don't think he got nearly as much shine as he could have, and now all these guys will get some good shine. So we'll see what happens from there. Apparently, big announcements coming up from Triple H about the women. Probably will have a second Mae Young Classic. So that'll be pretty cool. Of course, what's her name? The sailor girl there won it last year.
Kari Sane.
Kari Sane won it last year. I like her gimmick, the anchor and everything. I like her.
Yeah, it'll be interesting, though, because I think outside of that initial Cruiserweight Classic, have any of these classics had as much resonance or relevance? Like, the Mae Young thing was cool, but I don't feel like there were super lasting effects.
Right.
The UK tournament was cool, but you just said, like, when's the last time we mentioned Pete Dunne or Tyler Bate? Like, outside of that Cruiserweight Classic, which led to 205 Live, like, I don't think any of these tournaments have really had, you know, legs, so to speak.
Right. I agree. So we'll be curious to see if this expansion of both the NXT UK and the women workout. So we'll keep tabs on that.
We have co-branded takeovers.
Cobra. They'll be taking over each other's takeovers. Taking over the takeover. Be like NWO. So we'll see what happens. Obviously, today, Wednesday, as we're taping, the very sad news that came out this morning, Leon White, a.k.a. Vader, passed away at the age of 63 due to pneumonia. His body was weakened anyway. He had a lot of heart issues over the last couple of years. Very sad. Not in the Hall of Fame, which is criminal. I think it's funny, though, that a lot of new fans, Brother Nate, probably don't know a lot of Vader.
Mm.
Maybe they know the Attitude Era Vader, which is not the one we want to remember. The one we want to remember is the, 88 to 94 Vader, who was just an utter killer and maybe one of the best heels in the whole in the whole world for those, 5 years, 89 to late 94, early 95.
It was kind of funny looking on Twitter today at some of the people expressing their condolences and their memories of Vader. You could pretty clearly draw a line. Like, wrestling fans over the age of 30 to 35. Like, if you're older than that, you remember Vader from the NWA days or even the Attitude Era. If you're under that line, a lot of people remembered him from Boy Meets World. Yes. That's a lot of he's getting a lot of Boy Meets World love today, which was funny to me. But yeah, Vader was one of the best big men of all time. One of the greatest feuds in WCW history was Vader and Sting. And Vader was also the man who dropped the belt to Ron Simmons. So yeah, I got a lot of love for Vader. This is not a surprise. I guess you're never fully prepared to hear the news of somebody's past, but as you mentioned, he had been battling health issues for the last few years. But I'm if there's one thing I'm glad about, it's that I feel a lot of times people don't get their recognition and their respect while they're alive. Mm-hmm. And I feel like because Vader had a scare a couple years ago, he was able to get that love before he passed, and then people were, you know, oh yeah, I really appreciated Vader. He was one of my favorite heels back in the day. So it in a way that was a bit of a blessing in disguise because right. He got to get his flowers while alive.
I agree. I've got so many favorite Vader matches. We'll talk about that with Steve Willie in our next block. But I can off the top of my head strap match with Sting. Yep. I kind of dug the King of Cable. That was pretty good. Of course, the match that he had with Cactus on that Saturday night where he's pretty much stiffing him in the face over and over again. I just watched this match recently. I like the Fatal 4-Way he's in at In Your House, Final Four, him, Taker, Steve, and Brett. I love that. I like that match a lot. That's, of course, the match where his eyeball's almost hanging out. We will talk about Japan in the B block, but obviously he had a myriad of great matches in Japan. What are the WCWs? What other good feuds did he have? Well, obviously, yes, the match with Ron Simmons I like a lot, actually. Yeah, we'll have to take a peek at some of the great... I wonder if they'll do a Vader collection on the network. That would be pretty cool.
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me. And you mentioned it off the top, where this is a guy that probably should have been in the Hall of Fame. And it's unfortunate now that I think this expedites that.
I agree 100%. You're exactly right. And it's just sad. I mean, nobody likes death, obviously. But it's so sad seeing some of our contemporaries that we grew up with, even being sick. So, Leon White, Baby Bull, former L.A. Ram, a.k.a. Big Van Vader, dead at the age of 63 from apparently pneumonia, which obviously, with his weakened state from all the heart stuff and all the surgeries and stuff, I'm sure his body just couldn't handle it. Pneumonia's a killer. Pneumonia kills most people. It's not even like the sicknesses that kill them. It's something like pneumonia, which most people be like, all right, I feel like shit, and then you're better. But when your body's weakened from all these other health issues, something like pneumonia can
opens the gate,
finish you off. Yeah, exactly. Very sad. I remember seeing it this morning. I think his son posted on Twitter. And it took a while for a lot of news outlets to take it. Bleacher Report, it took like half an hour. WWE didn't post it. I saw it on Twitter at like 10:45 and this morning. And WWE didn't post it till I think almost 1:30. So maybe they were just trying to get confirmations. I don't think Lori.
Yeah, I would say
for,
yeah.
So
yeah, because it. I feel like there were kind of talks about it online like during the day, but it really didn't start ramping up until I want to say around 2 Eastern.
Right, and again, he died Monday. He didn't even die today. He died Monday.
Yeah.
So it's weird that we hadn't heard about it. Very strange. But in any event, let's take a break. Great first segment, Brother Nate. When we come back, we'll be joined by the conscience of Place to Be Nation, Steve Wille. And we'll talk a little Vader. He'll let us know his thoughts on NXT Takeover Chicago this past Saturday as he was there with one of his youngins. And then we will have our newest edition of the New Japan Classic Match Pick. And I love my pick. I thought it was a good one. I thought it was a little change of pace. And Chad Campbell will be proud. Brother Nate, Brother Scott, The Conscience, coming up next. Stay tuned.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
Hey, pro wrestling announcer Kevin Kelly here. I want to make sure you are all subscribed to all the great feeds here at Place to Be Nation. It's really easy to do. Just head to iTunes or your preferred podcatcher app today and search and subscribe to the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed, which, of course, includes the full archives of the Kevin Kelly Show, the Place to Be Nation pod feed, and the pro wrestling only feed. Subscribe, listen, and then rate us and leave feedback today. And be sure to give Justin your true thoughts. I mean, don't hold back. After all, he is kind of a jerk. Just listen to Scott.
Place for Nations, JT Rosero and Chad Campbell here. We want to let you know that we have a ton of great podcasts available to you on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and PlaceofNation.com. We offer them to you on two great feeds. On the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed, we bring you the Mothership, the Place to Be podcast, along with Main Event, Survey Says, the Monday Night Wars, and our monthly pay-per-view reaction show, as well as Jeff Learns Wrestling. In addition to these full-length shows, we also deliver special network podcasts and pod blasts on topics old and new.
Over on the Pro Wrestling Only feed, we dive deep inside the wrestling business with a stacked army of experts leading the way. The feed features potpourri shows such as This Week in Wrestling, Greetings from Allentown, Match of the Week podcast, and the Military Industrial Suplex. We also have shows that focus intently on certain topics like Through the Years, Worldcast, Strong Style History, Strong Style Story, and Mount Olympus. Plus, the feed has the full archives of legendary shows like Titans of Wrestling, Where the Big Boys Play, Letters from Center Stage, and Letters from Kayfabe, plus much more. And on our very popular Place to Be Nation Pop podcast feed, we offer such great shows as Talkin' Pop, the Glenn Butler Podcast Hour Spectacular, NBA Team, PTBN Play, Sunday Groove, Breaking Balls, and Lucha Undead,
as well as a veritable podcast heaven for comics fans
with the Hard Traveling Fanboys, Sellers Points, Todd Weber's Conversations, Geek and Sassy, and Marvel Age Podcasts.
You can find all of these current shows, plus archives of our past podcasts, including The Kevin Kelly Show, as well by subscribing to both feeds on iTunes. And while there, be sure to rate and leave feedback today. All these shows, plus others, available at PlaceofNation.com, where we cover pro wrestling, sports, movies, comics, plus in-depth stretch projects, and more. Be sure to support our site by using PlaceofNation.com/Amazon when doing your online shopping, and download our free PTB Vintage Vault Refresh ebooks via the links on our site. We also want to thank our friends at Boneheads, Wing Bar in West Warwick, Rhode Island, and Fall River, Massachusetts, and TheHistoryOfWrestling.com. Be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Tumblr as well. PlaceofNation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
We are back on Place to Be Nation's main event, episode 104. Of course, you got the Godfather, Scotty, and we had to bring in the third man of our team for this segment. There's been a bit of a theme this week, Scott. In the A block, we talked about Big Cass getting released. Mm-hmm. We talked about the unfortunate passing of Big Van Vader. Mm-hmm. And so to continue the theme, I think it's only right, it's only fitting if we bring in the third man of our rotation, Big Wille Styles.
Ah, you took Ooh. It. That's exactly what I was thinking. Damn, the show is awesome.
Steve Wille, how you doing this week, brother?
I'm doing pretty good. How's everyone?
I think Big Cass needs you.
I'm a little sad about Vader. My friends from back in college always joked about how a young Leon White in AWA resembles my father almost 100%. So I will have to send a comparison pic. Yeah, except Leon had a lot less hair, but they look virtually identical to the point where I tricked my son when he was 4 and saw the picture.
Wow.
What's funny. Grandpa Dave doing? Where's his hair?
that is hilarious. Wow. Well, Brother Steve, it's always good to have you, man.
Yeah, great.
Chad Campbell was to join us this evening, of course, for the New Japan segment, but he had a family commitment he needed to take care of. So we miss you, Chad, and we love you always. But he does have some written comments about our match tonight, but we'll get to the match in a minute. Brother Steve, Brother Nate and I talked about Money in the Bank. Obviously, we held off on talking about NXT TakeOver Saturday night because Big Wille Style was in the house.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a long time since I've been at the Allstate Arena, which is my old stomping grounds. And speaking of my dad, he used to work about 2 blocks away from there. So it's kind of...
There you go. That's awesome.
Nice reminiscing being in that building and then remembering how small it actually is, especially for wrestling events these days with the big giant stage, and there's only like 13,000 people who can fit in there now. But definitely a surreal experience for me because I've been in so many wrestling shows in my life, and this is the first one that I have my child with me. So very special. I wasn't watching the same way as I usually would, as kind of watching through his eyes as well. And he's only seen one wrestling show before this, which was the previous TakeOver, which I watched in the past week. So he already has his favorites. He already has the guys he doesn't like. And it was a great time.
There's a song in there somewhere, Steve. There's like a contemporary rock song. Like, looking at the ring through my child's eyes. Oh, who's man, going over? Love.
Something Darius Rucker would sing, you know?
It'll be Darius Rucker or Scott Stapp, maybe it's a duet.
Yeah, exactly, yes. Well, it's kind of like having, you know, the guys from Titans sing like Harry Chapin, you know? Sitting back with my son, watching Chief J Strongbow, you know, now it's totally different now, so. Before we get to TakeOver, Steve, any comments you have on Sunday on Money in the Bank?
I've just watched a little bit so far, so I don't really have anything out of the ordinary. I've been spoiled a million times over between people on Facebook and people coming in my office all jacked up about it. So a little surprised with Braun winning, just because it doesn't seem like he's someone who actually needs the briefcase. He can have a title shot at any time he wants to. Yep. I thought Natalya was going to win the Money in the Bank. It seemed to be where the story was going. I'm very interested to see Ronda's snapping on Monday Night Raw once I catch up later this week. So I've heard really great things about that.
It looked awesome. It was great.
Yeah. So as I was talking to a friend this morning, between how good he thought the pay-per-view was and how good the last 2 days of shows are, he's hoping there's a little bit of a turn of a corner and a heating up to SummerSlam.
I agree. All right, here are your results from Saturday. We have the Undisputed Era, Mr. O'Reilly and Roddy, retain the NXT tag titles with a win over Oney Lorcan and Danny Burch. we are staying spoiler-free, so we'll leave it at that. Ricochet, who's slowly becoming like my favorite guy in this company, top five. In fact, I saw somebody with a Ricochet t-shirt on this weekend, which I actually like. I like the red Ricochet shirt. I may actually get one. He defeated Velveteen Dream in 22-10. I saw parts of that match. It was very, very good. I didn't catch these last three matches, so I have to watch these myself. Shayna Baszler retaining the women's title with a submission win over Nikki Cross in 9:25. Aleister Black defeats Lars Sullivan to retain the NXT title in 14:07. And in the main event, part two of the trilogy, because we know it's going to be a trilogy, Tommaso Ciampa defeats Johnny Gargano in 35:29 in a Chicago street fight, which, by the way, Steve, 4 minutes and 14 seconds longer than AJ Nock was one night later.
Wow.
So it was the longest match of the weekend, was Ciampa and Gargano. First off, your overall thoughts from there, and did your son, was he like, how did he feel just with the overall live feeling? And give us like the live feel before we dive into like the meat and potatoes.
Especially in the first few matches, the crowd was quite alive. I would say coming to a crescendo at the Ricochet Velveteen Dream match, and I didn't think it was going to get much louder after the Undisputed Era match, which exceeded my expectations for sure. I love Roddy. I love Kyle O'Reilly. I love Adam Cole. And it started off a little bit slow after the initial, big pop for mainly Adam Cole, who didn't even wrestle that night, including for the television tapings. And once Oney Lorcan got tagged in and just went crazy on offense, the place just started coming unglued for that match. And I didn't know how they were going to top it with Ricochet, Velveteen Dream. Like, I know they're capable, but you can only sustain a crowd for so long. So the ironically, it was the two singles title matches that paid the price for that. Because everyone knew that Tommaso and Gargano was going to be just a crazy mess of a match in the best of all possible ways.
All right. You had said to me when you had said in one of the chats when you were chatting that there were even a couple of spots where you were, because again, you were saying, watching going to a show by yourself or with other grown-ups is one thing, but when you're going with one of your children, you're looking at things differently. And I, for at least from what I've heard, I have not watched the match yet, that Ciampa and Gargano had a couple of, I don't want to say morally questionable, but tastefully questionable spots? I don't know.
There are a couple dangerous moments for sure. There are some sweet little callbacks, though, that I didn't really hear people talk about. Go back to one of the earlier Chicago, I mean, there hasn't been many in the WWE, but at WrestleMania 13, they had the Chicago street fight with the stop sign and the parking sign.
Yep,
and
against the Nation, yep.
The Nation, and they call back to that, plus, the ECW stop sign and the sign moment. A match like that is hard to see live. There's a lot that you miss, and where we were sitting, we couldn't really see the big screen. We can just see the ancient scoreboard at the Allstate Arena. I know why they run the Allstate Arena, but they should be running the United Center at this point. It holds 8,000 more and it has better amenities. The big table spot was a little bit scary, but it happened right in front of us. My kid hated the match. He said it was too violent and it was kind of scary. Scary for him.
Already a purist.
Yes.
It's a spot fest. So I need more psychology in the match.
Where's the story?
I don't, because we've had the talk at like, hey, they're not really trying to kill each other. And he's seen the videos that they were friends and they went to each other's wedding and he just like couldn't get to like, okay, if these guys are friends in real life, why are they doing this to each other? As opposed to, say, Aleister Black and Lars Sullivan, I guess, like you could tell they're trying to win. They're not trying to murder each other.
Right.
the guy's not trying to take his wedding ring off and chuck it into the stands.
That was crazy. From what I heard about that, that's nuts.
And we met Nigel McGuinness after the match. I've talked to him a few times, and he was in Ring of Honor, and he was doing his documentary. And then we kind of talked on the side when he started his podcast. And so, we were looking to host it back in the day. So he met up with us after the show, like right after the show, and he kind of said that he didn't really like it either, just from a, from a former wrestler perspective. He's not a big fan of seeing those kind of dangerous spots. I'm sure he, you know, he was working us a little bit, but he did
right.
You know, straight up tell Alex that it was, you know, kind of crazy seeing that up close. And yeah, it was a fun show live. And like I said, it was completely, I wasn't marking out for stuff as I was more looking for, you know, what his response was. I was also on edge about what the people around me were going to be chanting. So.
Yeah. Real quick, Steve, what did you make of Velveteen Dream coming out as the Immortal One?
I had a bunch of mixed feelings. And I had a lot of mixed feelings because I'm thinking to myself, is this an homage or is this a middle finger?
Yes.
You
walk the line, like, yeah, you could either read it as he's paying tribute to the Hulkster, or if he's, taking some of the piss out of Hulk Hogan.
Yeah, and he's the type of character who you can see both sides of it, and maybe it's both. You know, just like himself is, you know, kind of a, you know, throwback to an Adrian Street, you know, obviously... channeling Prince Iaukea, right? I mean, not the Prince. I mean, Prince Iaukea is who he's channeling there. So, yeah, at first I'm like, oh, this is really cool. And then, yeah, I think he's, like, giving a little bit of a middle finger to him, too, and I kind of like it.
And then, yeah, and then him and Ricochet did, like, the Hogan Rock WrestleMania spot. I thought pretty much that match. I definitely enjoyed the Gargano match. Shayna and Nikki was good for what it was. I really like Shayna, though. I don't know how much I like that match, but I really like her as kind of, like, she to me is what Brock Lesnar should be on the main roster.
And she's a student of the game, too. Like, I can imagine some people thinking, you know, who is she just to be MMA and coming in and do this, but she would be in the front row on all the PWG shows, and she is a huge fan. And it's nice to see it clicking for her.
Yeah.
Because it's not like she's been around for that long. And these are big shows. And I would say the match against Ember Moon, which I just got to see for the first time recently, and this match, like, ooh, this is a lot different than when she started. You can see she's starting to get the confidence and starting to play to the crowd a little bit more. I thought that was probably... besides the match for one of the matches for the taping that will air this week, was probably the least popular match of the night. Yet it was still decent.
What do you think of Aleister Black as champion? Did he get a good? Was he? He had that aura about him, you know, leading up to when he finally won it. Does he have that aura about him right now still? Like, from a live perspective?
I think so. I think he got saddled with an opponent who was not ready to be in that spotlight, but kind of outkicked his coverage. I think Lars did a lot better than at least I expected. Looking like he could stay in there, except with the one giant botched spot at the end, which I blame both of them for. I think if he can get some decent opponents... you know, you could see Ricochet, you could see Velveteen Dream. I mean, there's a ton of guys who we can... I can see Ciampa going up against them soon. I think those matches will be incredible. He does have this mystique to him, almost like a mini Undertaker. His introductions are always pretty over huge. That was kind of a neat thing from a kid to see. Just how they set all that up and prepared for it. Because it wasn't a show that had many great... entrances, no concerts this time, and I think that's also due to the lack of space in the arena. I was hoping for some big monster concert for him, but alas, so it goes.
You're hoping for Darius Rucker and Scott Stapp to sing his theme song?
Oh yeah, definitely. To sing out Nikki Cross.
That's funny.
So, what's the DX band doing these days?
Didn't he die?
Did he?
The lead singer. You're talking about the guys from WrestleMania 14, right? I think
the guys they were kind of like the Walmart version of Rage Against the Machine.
The Walmart.
like the great value Rage Against the Machine.
Great value. Yeah, what's his face? The something Walters band or?
No, I didn't know he died.
Died in June of 2016.
Yeah.
Oh man, rest in peace. They had some good songs. Like the Triple H theme song they did was pretty good.
They did X-Pac.
Yeah.
X-Pac.
Yeah.
Yeah. No,
they had some good songs.
They did.
He's always so angry in those songs. Don't tell me what to do. Are you asking me a question? Like, why are you so angry right now, sir?
He was about 30 something when that. He was about 30 something when he made that song too. The teenage angst.
Yes. Yeah.
It's like Triple H and Shawn coming back, and they were still Degeneration X, and they're in their 40s.
Yep. Oh, rest in peace. What was his name, Scotty?
What was it? Chris Walters? Was that what it was?
Chris Walters.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Rest in peace, Chris Walters.
Yes. All right. Steve, any thoughts on the sad death of Mr. Big Van Vader?
Not a terrible surprise. His health has been pretty poor for a long time. I know he had gone through a couple of surgeries, and he had pneumonia. And I'll tell you, I had pneumonia a couple of years ago, and it knocked me on my ass for about a month. I don't know if you remember that, Scott.
Yes,
but
I
we
do.
Did.
I do.
The Halloween episode, I went a couple of years ago. I ended up in the urgent care the next day because it was a pain, and I'm a pretty healthy guy, and Vader is a 63-year-old, or was a 63-year-old, very large man, and with a history of health problems, so it wasn't a shock. He was one of my favorite heels of all time in the 90s, so I'm still reeling over the Anthony Bourdain death. Celebrity deaths don't really get to me that much anymore, and maybe it's just a sign of getting older. That one, it hit me a lot more than this one, and I think there's just been so much bad news in the last couple of weeks that I'm just—it's just not even really affecting me that much. So I know a couple guys have talked about, watching some matches today and that, and I'll get to it, but it's not like I don't watch his matches all the time anyway.
Exactly, right.
That's with the New Japan service, as we'll talk about shortly. There's no shortage of great classic matches on there.
Yep.
Well, I had said that they may end up doing a collection anyway. So.
And he should have been in the Hall of Fame. Like, I didn't even realize he was in the Hall of Fame. He should have been there 10 years ago.
He should have. I mean, he inducted Stan Hansen.
Yeah.
So he obviously was not in the total crapper, and he was on wasn't he at a table for 3-2?
I believe so. Yeah, one of the early ones.
I think it was with your boy Nate. I think it was. Wasn't it him, Sting, and somebody? I think it was him, Sting, and Steamboat. Maybe something like that.
That sounds about right. Because it was the WCW theme.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, maybe it was DDP. Because he's always on those like generic ones as like the host.
Yeah, because I think the thing that because whoever the third guy was, like both people were connected to Sting, but whoever the third guy was had no connection to Vader. So it was like this weird, it was this weird setting where Sting and Vader would talk, then Sting and the other guy would talk, and then the other guy would,
yeah,
it was DDP. Okay, and DDP was like, yeah, I was a fan of you, big guy, and then Vader was like, yeah, you were pretty good too. Now let's go back to talking to Sting, because he's the connective tissue here.
Yeah, exactly.
yeah, because that would have been right after Sting came in for WrestleMania.
Correct.
Yeah, so it was probably 2015. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Speaking of Japan, Brother Nate and Brother Steve, it is time for our newest installment of the New Japan Classic Match Pick. And this was my pick. And a complete 180 from my first match pick, which I'm sure Chad was thrilled about. we are going back to February 5th, 1980, from the prefectorial, whatever that place is called, that they do a lot of stuff in, the prefectorial gymnasium, something of that nature. And the idea, the WWF Junior Heavyweight Championship is on the line. Your champion is Mr. Tatsumi Fujinami, and he is being challenged by a guy that would eventually hold gold in the World Wrestling Federation later on in the decade. I am, of course, speaking of the Dynamite Kid, who was wearing long tights and had a shaved head. Just a little background on our future WWE Hall of Famer. Fujinami won the Junior Heavyweight Championship on January 23rd, 1978. Speaking of Hulk Hogan, look at that, huh? 6 years to the day later, he would become the Hulkamania would begin. But here, he defeats Jose Estrada, because when I think of junior heavyweights, I think of Jose Estrada, at Madison Square Garden, and brought it to Japan, establishing it as the premier junior heavyweight title in Japan. And I remember seeing him when on the Place to Be podcast, when Mr. Azero and I rebooted and started with the house shows and started in 1985. I believe it was February of 85. No, that's what would be War to Settle the Score. I think it had to have been April. I think it was April of 85. Tatsumi Fujinami actually came and had a was in a house show match. I can't remember who he wrestled, but I think it was Matt Bourne, I want to say. But I hadn't really seen too much Fujinami up to this point. Steve, how much did you know about him? Like, when did you first kind of get your feet wet with, I mean, this guy, obviously Hall of Famer, one of the greatest ever. When did you get your first taste of him?
I haven't seen that much of him. He was a little bit before my time of watching Japan. I didn't really watch that much 80s. I went more into the 90s because that's, I really got into Japan wrestling in the late 90s. So I kind of went with what was available at the time. So there's really not much. He probably made a couple WCW stops along
yep.
the way, and well, more NWA time period. So I remember him from that. But yeah, I saw a couple of the Ric Flair matches, but especially this early on, 1980, I've probably seen more Dynamite Kid at this time than I have right. Fujinami.
What about you, Nate? When was your first look at Fujinami?
Yeah, it would have been the early 90s with the Flair stuff.
Yep. Super Brawl.
Because, mm-hmm. yes, yep. That it, and, you know, it was hard to get a gauge on how good Fujinami was because he was in there with Flair. Who could make anybody look good, particularly at that time frame. But, yeah, I think that was my first exposure to him. And then, you know, obviously kind of going back and looking at some of the matches in New Japan's history, you get a little bit more familiar with him. But, yeah, that would have been my initial exposure to Fujinami.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I actually didn't see – I agree with you guys. I didn't see my first look at Fujinami till Super Brawl myself. And, of course, we're talking about Super Bowl 91 when he was actually WCW champion and NWA champion, and that's when the split happened, and the belt split, yep. and Flair ended up winning both anyway. As for Dynamite, I knew pretty much nothing about Dynamite until he was in the British Bulldogs. I don't really
sure.
– I never saw him even before that. What about you, Nate?
Honestly, I didn't know much other than hearing the name Dynamite Kid and maybe seeing a picture of the British Bulldogs in one of the after mags. I was not as familiar with him until probably Benoit came around because obviously there's a big influence to Benoit's style from the Dynamite Kid. And so Benoit, it was kind of like one of those old music ads in a magazine. Like, if you like Run DMC, check out the Get Fresh crew. And so it's like, if you like Chris Benoit, check out Dynamite Kid. And that was kind of how I discovered more of his stuff. But yeah, it would have been way after, you know, his peak and his prime.
Now, in his early career, to kind of set the tone here, obviously he was working for Stampede Dynamite and got to know, you know, Stu. Where's Aaron when you need him? He's the best Stu ever. Worked in Stampede extensively. Worked with Bruce Hart and, of course, some rookie named Brett, some greasy guy. Despite differences between them due to comments Kid made about Stu in his autobiography, Brett still regards him as pound for pound the greatest wrestler who ever lived. This is interesting. Now, we're, of course, the big thing with Dynamite Kid is his use of steroids. And I'm kind of surprised by this. Do you know who introduced, according to Wikipedia, so we have to take this with a grain of salt, I suppose. You know who introduced Dynamite Kid to steroids? JYD.
Mm.
Apparently he introduced Billington, of course his real name, to Diana Ball.
Hmm. Interesting.
And maybe by 1987, JYD should have taken some steroids instead of eating endless bags of pork rinds. But
I mean, you need a firm grip if you're going to grab those cakes. So.
Yeah, that's true. And he was also introduced to speed, amphetamines in Stampede.
Jesus.
Guess by who? Jake Roberts. What a shot. Mm.
Now that one makes more sense. That's a bit more on the nose.
Yes. After doing big business in Canada, Dynamite was booked on his first tour of Japan, working for International Pro Wrestling, IPW, in July of 79. Stu and Stampede switched their business relationship from IPW to, of course, New Japan shortly after Dynamite's first tour, and he wrestled from New Japan from January of 80 to August of 84. Perhaps the most memorable matches that came out of Dynamite's run in New Japan were his legendary feud with Tiger Mask, where I'm sure we'll talk about matches, those two, with them down the line. But this one that we're talking about tonight was the first, and they wrestled each other. Oh God, they probably wrestled Fujinami and Kid probably wrestled. I'm looking at Mr. Lariato, the guy on Twitter that has the big comprehensive list. I'm trying to look and see how many matches they had, and we may do another one down the line, but this is the very first one, February 5th, 1980, for that WWF Junior Heavyweight title. I watched it on the New Japan app. I'm sure we all did. What did you think of Fujinami's presence, Nate, in the ring? Like, did he have? I know, you know, Kid was pseudo rookie to a certain extent, so he wasn't as well known. But I don't know. Fujinami just had this kind of like Inoki, where he had just this aura about him that a lot of other smaller guys sometimes can't get away with. But I feel like Fujinami had this aura about him when he was in the ring.
It's funny because we talked about the match of Flair, and I'm not going to go as far as to say he was Ric Flair, but there were some, like the way he carried himself, there was a Flair-like presence. And it was interesting because, you know, you mentioned those Tiger Mask matches, and those are the ones. Like, I haven't watched a lot of Dynamite Kid, but I've watched a bunch of Dynamite and Tiger Mask. And so that's what I'm more familiar with. And this was, I'm not going to say this was completely different, but if that's what you were expecting going into this match, for any of the listeners that watched the match with us, that watched the match this week, that was not what you were going to get. You know, you were going to get one of the guys from that movie, but this was going to be... this is going to be like Solo. It's a Star Wars story. It's not the Star Wars. It's this offshoot that is its own thing. And, you know, once we get into the match, like, I think you kind of see the dichotomy between this version of Dynamite Kid and Fujinami.
Hmm. What do you think, Steve? Did New Japan do a good job of creating this aura for Fujinami? There's another match on New Japan in the World app where he defended the title against Kengo Kimura the previous December of 79. I actually watched that match too. It was very good. Well, not as good as this one, but very good. Fujinami just seemed to have this aura about him, I thought anyway. Carried himself well. What'd you think?
There is just so much pomp and circumstance before and after this match. That it made him look even bigger because he wasn't flashy. He had a pair of black trunks.
Yep.
You know, nowadays that's like what the young boys wear before they're allowed to create their character. It's just him standing there ripped as all get out, wearing black trunks and just ready to go, and he was a superstar. And that was one of the things about both guys' looks. I mean, especially if you would look from Dynamite Kid from the neck down, because whew, that was a rough head that guy had.
Yes.
And he looked like a soccer hooligan almost.
Oh, he definitely had that one. He was a hooligan anyway.
Yeah. But these guys would fit in any promotion today. I could see them both being in NXT right now and being huge stars. They're not too big, they're not too small. They're both pretty jacked. They had that thin, lean, muscular look that a lot of your Ring of Honor NXT type guys have. I mean they look better than Daniel Bryan.
Yes.
Fujinami definitely kind of throws you off because you think he's got more of a kind of a regular heavyweight build, and he really doesn't. I mean, he was probably at his peak. He was probably maybe 230, probably. 227. He was billed as weighing 227.
He reminded me a lot of the first match we watched, which was the Shibata match, mm-hmm. Shibata Okada. They have a similar look. And I don't know if that was done purpose on Shibata, but they're both, you know, very lean and muscular, but simple in terms of what they're bringing to the dance, yep. Clothes-wise.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. The crowd was into it, obviously. I don't know how big this venue was, or I don't know how big that prefectorial gymnasium seats. It didn't look like a lot. Maybe 6,000, 7,000.
Sounds like an imperfectorial gymnasium,
exactly.
If you ask me.
You know who needs to put some money into the prefect? Byron Allen, because he's going to tell you a couple of stiff shots coming up next.
That's the question. Could Ring of Honor sell out the prefectural gymnasium?
Yeah. The first thing I took away from this match, particularly in the first, like, the clip on, I would say the match is probably 12 minutes, maybe 13 minutes. The whole clip on the New Japan app, it was like 21:45, but there was intros and interviews at the end. The match itself is probably 13 minutes. So it's not bad. It's a quick watch. And the first thing I gathered is that they were stiffing the shit out of each other. I mean, there was definitely no holding back, Steve. I mean, they were smacking each other around pretty good.
Oh, yeah. Even the body slam right off the bat from Dynamite Kid was pretty stiff. He put a little extra oomph on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. And that, for me, was... Yeah, he dominated it pretty much the whole match. It was, yep. Fujinami working from behind and getting these quick little comebacks that kept getting cut off. And, you know, we should probably mention right away that Fujinami had a bandage on his head. That was, I'm assuming, a cut from the night before, because even at the beginning of the match, there was a little blood underneath it.
Yeah, yep. Were you taken aback, Nate, by the immediate stiffness of the match in the beginning? I thought they would have kind of settled in for a couple minutes and then started freaking potatoing each other, but forget it. It was, like, right out of the gate.
Yeah, it was, particularly, you know, coming off of those Tiger Mask matches, which were a bit more technical than this and less brutal. But I like the story, like, of Dynamite coming in here, basically trying to run through Fujinami and, you know, going at it and just basically brutalizing this dude for, I'd say, 75-80% of the match. And then that aggressiveness ends up getting turned on him the longer we get into the match. So I like the story. It was a different Dynamite than I was used to, that I had seen, but I thought it fit with what they were doing in this match.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I feel like that Dynamite was just going to keep blunt hitting him. But it was that one move, the one move that took me aback. I think he was doing some kind of like a submission, almost like it might have been like an abdominal stretch, and they actually tangled each other in the ropes, and they both fell out, which, right. I don't know how often you saw that, even in early 80s New Japan, where they actually get outside the ring a lot. And then they just started, like, shoving each other. And I'm like, all right, now we're getting down to my kind of... now we're getting a little Jesse Ventura dirty action here. and that kind of helped me enjoy the match. I was going to love it anyway, but... I think the extra... hooligan. I think I'm going to use your noun, Steve. feel that Dynamite brought to the match, like almost like a street fight kind of thing, I think added a little flavor to it. What do you think about that, Steve?
I did, because he had, you know, you mentioned him being stiff, and he had this kind of, the first probably 4 or 5 minutes of the match, you catch him giving this evil sneer, yep. when he was trying to work a hold on the mat. And at first, the first couple of minutes, I thought it was just going to be a more of a face-versus-face match because there was a mutual respect. Even when they dumped outside the ring, they kind of looked at each other, pushed each other a couple of times, but both went right back to the ring, and the crowd gave that kind of polite applause. I'm like, oh, okay, this is going to be... Oh, he had butted him in the face.
Yep. Yeah. What a shock.
Yeah. I believe he actually cut his own nose open, by the way, because he had a bloody nose at one point, and I'm like, where did that come from? And the only thing I could think of is one of those headbutts.
Yeah.
That is ludicrous. Not surprising. But now we know what kind of problem. Now we know where the problems would come later on down in
his. Yeah, this is funny because it reminds me, Steve had mentioned the Shibata match.
Mm-hmm.
And it reminds me, like, there were points in this match where I had sort of the same kind of feeling where, while on the one hand, this is a really good match, on the other hand, I was like, did you really have to do that, Dynamite? Did you need to go that far? Can we save something for the next time around?
Nick, can you not give yourself a concussion?
Yeah. I don't need to see another diving headbutt after this match.
Yeah, I mean, it was... Yeah. There were some moments that it was getting, they were really, you know, moving the needle, I thought, Steve.
Yeah, and you know, the story of the match, too, was besides Fujinami working from underneath, was Dynamite Kid just working the cut and busting him back open, which you don't see blood that much in New Japan, and maybe at this time period it was different, but it's very, very rare these days, unless you're involved with Chris Jericho, apparently. And... And at one point, the blood was kind of went away on Fujinami's head, and Dynamite Kid started biting him. And it's like, usually it's like, oh, that's, you know, that's totally fake. He's just like pretend gumming him. And yeah. Well, now he's bleeding. Did he actually bite his cut back open? Because I wouldn't put it past him. Where everyone else, I would just think, oh, yeah, that's all smoke and mirrors.
yeah, crazy smoke and mirrors. There's no doubt about that. I think I'm sorry, Steve, go ahead.
What'd you guys think of you see Samoa Joe these days casually walk away from planchas and dives, and I'm like, oh, that's where Joe got that from.
Yeah,
he did it twice, one on a dropkick running up the ropes, and he just stopped and walked away, and then on the ill-conceived dive by Fujinami, and he just casually just walked off to the lap with a smirk on his face.
Yeah. And what I like in terms of psychology is Dynamite Kid, I think, was trying to get under Fujinami's skin during most of the match, and I feel like Fujinami did an amazing job of kind of keeping it real and keeping it focused and didn't let the little needling and the stiff punches and that kind of stuff get to him. Where he stayed very level-headed, so I thought that was I was impressed by that.
Technically, he did get under his skin with the biting.
Well,
I mean,
literally under his skin.
Literally,
this is what clean blood tastes like. Blood is orange,
sucking the life force out of him.
Yes.
Well, he needed a transfusion at that point.
Yes. Why Dynamite keeps getting younger over the course of this match?
It's kind of like this season of Flash with, you know, Brainiac sucking all the Dark Force elements out of everybody. Fujinami gets the win with a nice roll up, a very nice roll up. One of those the I don't know, what would you call it, Steve? Like the shins.
You know, I looked it up this morning. It's something like a dragon cradle or
cradle, yeah.
Yeah, a name I don't know, and I apologize.
Nah, that's why we would have had Chad. He would have remembered it. Dragon cradle. So he retains the heavyweight title, the junior heavyweight title, and then, which I didn't even notice, before they started throwing the streamers in, Dynamite gets some boots in, which told me that aha, this is beginning now. What'd you think of the end, Nate? And what'd you think of the extra kind of little boots that Dynamite brought in at the end there, maybe to keep this going?
I liked it. I liked that. Again, talking about the story in this match, it was Dynamite's aggressiveness that ultimately led to his own demise. And because Fujinami kind of kept his head through the course of the match, he was able to come away with the win. I like the pinning combination. And then, you know, you talk about the post-match stuff. It's something that I feel like at this time in New Japan, we didn't really get as much.
Right.
It feels very Western in that, you know, we're going to keep this angle going. So, yeah, it was a nice little wrinkle in the match. And I think the mark of a good match is if you can go in with no prior knowledge of what the story is and then come out of it, you want to see another match, then they've done their job as storytellers. And coming off of this, I'm like, yeah, I wouldn't mind watching another go-round with these two. Hopefully less bloody, but yeah, I'd still watch another one.
Eating cut. Steve, what did you think of the finish and then the extracurriculars?
I like the finish because Dynamite was trying to outstiff and just, you know, slug and headbutt, and Fujinami was basically able to out-wrestle him. And I did look up the name, and I wasn't even close. It was a Japanese roll leg clutch. And thanks to PWO for helping me with that, which sounds like a Japanese candy that you could find in a store somewhere in, you know, San Francisco or something.
It sounds like Vince McMahon making up the name. It's a Japanese leg rolling clutch. What a maneuver!
I'd rather hear myself as Chad go Dragon Cradle. Let's call it George.
Yes.
Speaking of Chad, Chad did have a written note for us, and I want your guys' opinion of his comment. This was his comment on the match. This really cemented Fujinami as the ace of juniors, and that this helped create a template that Dynamite and Tiger Mask would follow starting in 1981. Nate, does Dynamite carry this over to Tiger Mask? Because you said Tiger Mask, you know, those matches were a little more technically sound, a little more grounded.
Yeah.
Do you think that he took some of the viciousness and added it to that feud?
Now that I didn't know that note that Chad had sent before this, but yeah, it kind of feels like, and this might be a weird analogy, but it feels like the Blade movies back in the day, mm-hmm. the Blade movies that I think were made by New Line Cinema, if you took that and you took, you know, some basic story elements and you brought it to the current Marvel Cinematic Universe, which is co-owned by Disney, mm-hmm. you couldn't get away with everything that you could back in those earlier Blade movies, but you could get the basic essence of it. And I think that's what we got with the Tiger Mask feud, where it's not as visceral, it's not as bloody, it's a little bit more technically sound. But it feels like, yeah, if we're following this character of Dynamite Kid, it feels like he learned something through the matches with Fujinami, and so now he's adding a little bit more technical expertise to the brutality.
What do you think of Chad's analysis, Steve?
I did like it. Tiger Mask was starting a little bit more of the high flying, and then Dynamite would kind of go in, and it showed the versatility of Dynamite, and yeah. makes you really understand. You know, I watched more of Dynamite Kid in the British Bulldogs, and you know, like the snap suplexes and all that, and you saw where Benoit would pretty much get most of his work written, you know, whom he had pretty as much. his mentor. And this shows the versatility that he had, where he can go super stiff and throw strikes, but then also bleed right into more of a high-flying type match. You know, the different type people have the idea that junior matches have to be spot fest, and they really don't. It's
no.
You want to have a well-rounded division just like you would in the heavyweight division.
Yep, I agree 100%. So there you go. So check the match out. It is on New Japan's World app. Check it out.
Definitely recommend it.
Yes, oh, highly recommend it. Thank you. I appreciate everyone's excitement about that, the participation of that match. So check that out on New Japan World. All right, before we go, Brother Nate, the floor is yours. It is your turn. Give us our next classic match pick.
Yes, well, the floor may be mine, but I'm going to pull my Captain Planet or maybe Don Cheadle as Captain Planet. the power is mine, bitches. but I'm going to give the power to the people because I wanted to do something to remember Vader. And so I think what I want to do is do a double feature because want to do Vader's initial match in New Japan against Inoki from December of 87. But I went and watched that match today, and really it's like a 10-minute match. I watched it on Daily Motion, and it like only the last 2 minutes involve Vader. So it's like another match that's going on, and then Vader debuts at the end of that match. So I think what I want to do is take a look at Vader's debut, but then also do another match. And so I think what I want to do is come up with three matches, and then we can put it up on our Facebook group and allow the listeners to select the complement match to the debut of Vader in New Japan.
Okay. I like that.
I like it.
I'm game.
So we'll definitely take a look at Vader's debut from December 27th in 1987 against Antonio Inoki. But I'm going to check the master list, if you will, and pick three good Vader matches, and then we'll put them up on the Facebook page. And let the people vote for which other match we can talk about next time.
Do you have the date, Nate, for that debut? I have, if it's the one you're thinking of, I have... according to what our man, Mr. Lariato, February 7th, 88?
Yeah, that's a different one, because, yeah, that's a full match. This 12-27-87 match, I didn't know if it was on New Japan World or not, but it is on Daily Motion, but it's really just the last 2 minutes and 45 seconds, I think, of that match where Vader debuts. So we can talk about his initial debut, and then... I'll check the master list and pick three different Vader matches that different opponents, different time periods, and give the listeners a good variety to select from.
On a side note, he did wrestle a guy that we were talked about tonight. He actually wrestled Fujinami. In February of 89. I mean, we got Vader stuff all over the place. That's hot stuff. So check out.
He had a really good match with Hashimoto in 89, I think. He had some really good matches with Bam Bam Bigelow in Japan.
He also teamed with Bigelow. He actually wrestled, of course, the matches with Stan Hansen. We'll have to put, obviously, those speak for themselves. There's a good tag floating around here somewhere. Where is it? I'm looking at the list now. Where is it? Oh, here it is. Vader and Bigelow against Muto and Hase.
Ooh.
That is May 1st, 92. So that's an interesting one. So yeah, we'll come up with
that with the list.
Yeah, we'll come up with three. We're going to come up with three matches, and check it out on our Place to Be Nation's Main Event Facebook page, and we're going to give you the chance to vote. So we're going to do the last 2 minutes and 45 seconds of the match between Inoki and Vader, where Vader makes his debut in Japan in 87, and then we will talk about one other match based on the three that we post on the Facebook page. So please check the Facebook page out all the time. All updates on the show, and you will vote, and we will pick the match that everybody votes for, so check it out. That'll wrap it up for this edition of the Main Event. Brother Nate, you're the man. Pleasure as always. When's the next KOS popping up?
It will be this weekend, Kings of Sport with myself and Marcus Vandenberg from Yahoo Sports. It'll be this weekend, probably Friday or Saturday, coming off of the NBA draft.
Yes, the draft is tomorrow, I think, or tonight. Tonight or Thursday, depending when you're listening to this. Steve, you're awesome. Whenever you're on, we can give you Cass's number if you need some help.
Got some screens to put in on the second floor.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Yes. Maybe he could learn how to stop road raging bathroom doors. So Steve will be back.
I also want to nominate. I know people up in Titan Towers listen to this show, Scotty. So if your boy Paul is listening, I nominate Steve's son to replace Jonathan Coachman on the commentary desk because
he's got some hot takes, guys.
He makes more sense in that one question about the NXT match than Coach has in his entire return to the commentary table.
And I love Coach, but he said something so dumb that even Corey Graves said, "Why are you still working here?"
It's not just Coach. Like, this Coach, this version of Coach is not working, but it's also like this version of Coach plus Graves plus Cole. Like, the whole unit, like, doesn't work. Because I like Corey Graves, but I think he works so much better on SmackDown than on Raw, where, like, Raw, it feels like everybody's just trying to get a shot in, and it takes away from the show.
Yeah. Yeah. So... I vote for that as well. And I know, and of course Paul's listening because I'm on the show. Of course he's listening. In 2 weeks we'll be back with
I want to hear his analysis on the Bayley Sasha feud.
Yes, exactly.
They really just need to sit down and talk out their feelings.
Talk out their feelings. Need a doctor, what's his name? The one with what's his name? Lindsay something.
Oh, Dr. Shelby.
Dr. Shelby. We need Dr. Shelby again. All right, well, join us in 2 weeks. In our next episode, episode 105, you and I, Brother Nate and Steve, please feel free to join us. Well, you'll be joining us in the B block. I'll tell you why, of course, in a minute. But we will go over the first half year because we'll be our next episode. I think our next episode will be in the first week of July. So we will talk about the first 6 months of 2018 all over wrestling, see how things look so far, WWE, New Japan, et cetera, et cetera, and look ahead to the next 6 months. So we'll do that on the next show. And yes, Brother Steve, you know what's coming up next.
Mm-hmm.
Pay-per-view number 6 in the history of TNA. We do know, we can actually, because if you watched the last episode, we talked about episode 5, pay-per-view number 5, that we will have a world title match coming up. Ken Shamrock will take on Sabu, because Sabu won the ladder match with Malice. I believe we have a tag title match, even though the two tag champions are beating the shit out of each other. So, in any event, we will have a great TNA pay-per-view number 6 recap. The date is July 24th, 2002. So that'll be in 2 weeks. Hope you all are ready for it. For Brother Steve, for Brother Nate, I'm Brother Scott. You've been in the main event. We're all sober, so we can still stay with the company. Oh, also next week, we finally have reached the end, Brother Nate. Next week will be part 10, the final part of our 10-part series, breaking down our 100 greatest WWE wrestlers of all time. Next week, Brother Nate and I will finally be at 10-1. So look forward to that. Stay tuned for that coming up next week as well. Again, for Brother Steve, for Brother Nate, I'm Brother Scott. We're out. See you in 2 weeks.